introduce Dr. Professor Liu. He is the head of Huawei NOAC ARC lab and really famous scientist in the field of machine translation. And he will present his and our colleagues' recent work. Let us greet the speakers. Thank you.
Classification, I'm way more advantageous. Break it down and roll it up in them raw rolling paper. Sit and watch a rolling bishop put a few erotic mess. Thinking to myself, why these sharks are swimming in my head? I'm a prehistoric carnivore. They
hello, hello, okay, okay. A minor correction. I'm not the head of the lab. I'm the chief scientist of the speech and the NLP group in this lab. Okay, so today the topic of my presentation is document level neural machine translation. So this work is mainly done by one of my PhD students, so Longye Wang. So he obtained his PhD last year, and actually he was awarded the best PhD thesis this year by EAMT. So this is the work, his PhD work. So first I will introduce the motivation of document level machine translation, and I will give a very quick introduction of one of the work about drop pronoun translation, and then about document level machine translation models, and some conclusion. So first I will give an example, because you cannot understand the Chinese, as most of you don't understand Chinese, so I can directly go to the English translation. So this is a small piece of text from a fairy story, a Chinese fairy story. So this is there is a small mouse lived in China. So when he grew up, his mother take him out to find some feed, ask him to find some food by himself. So this is a very simple story. So you can see there are a lot of problems in this translation. So although it's quite well, you can basically understand, but you can see still a lot of problems. So first, inconsistent. So we can see that the Shook. Shook is the name of the small mouse. So you can see here is Shook, 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 Shooker. So the same name translates differently in the document. And also drop of pronoun. So in Chinese, it's very common we drop some pronouns, but in English it's not so frequently. So we can see the many errors here. So when in Chinese we say mother, we don't need to say my mother or your mother or a mother or the mother. We don't need to say, we just say mother. But in English you should say my mother or your mother or his mother. You should have a denominator there. So you can see that here is my mother, actually it should be his mother. And mother, you cannot say mother here, you should say his mother or your mother or my mother. So a mother, so my mother, his mother, so totally confusion. Okay, also mother said while bringing his teeth, so should be her teeth. Okay, you can see there's so many errors here. Also, so grind her teeth. So here, this is the same phrase in Chinese, but in English, here grinding his teeth, and here make a mother's teeth. So we totally understand what does it mean. Okay. So another piece of translation. So about a farmer and the snake. So this sentence, when we first mention some person, we should use a mother, a farmer, not a the mother, the farmer. So we can see that so many different many errors in this machine translation document. If you examine the text, the translation in the document level, you'll find a lot of errors. So first, the work is about, well, our work is about dropped pronoun translation. So okay, so we do a lot of work on this. So there are three piece of work. So first is about, we proposed a neural-based DP generator. That means, I've said that in Chinese we usually drop the pronouns, but we need to recover it before we translation. That's the idea. So we try to build a pronoun, dropped pronoun generator in the Chinese side before we translate it. So that's the idea. And then we propose some other models in the neural machine translation framework. I will go very quickly about this. So this is the papers we have published. So we have EMLP, XFAI, and machine translation, and NACO. So the first work is about DP generator, neural DP generator. So actually, it is quite hard, you know, because we dropped some pronoun in the Chinese. We try to find where is the dropped pronoun, and we need to determine which pronoun it is. So it's quite hard. So because there's no something missing, so you need to recover it. So this is very difficult. In Chinese, sometimes we also call it is a zero pronoun. Zero pronoun. So we need to recover a zero pronoun. So it's quite difficult. So however, we find a very good idea. We proposed a very good method idea to do this. So we use a large parallel copper, and we try to find the dropped pronoun using word alignment. Because if we have word alignment, we can see if there is a English pronoun was aligned to nothing in Chinese side. So we'll guess there's something missing. So we try to find a good correct position in the Chinese sentence, and we guess that there should be a pronoun, and we use this data, we can build a model to generate the dropped pronouns in Chinese side. So that's the basic idea. Okay. So you can see this is the sentence. In Chinese you can say like it, but in English you do you like this. So you, in Chinese we don't say you. So we can find, if we do alignment, we can find the English you was not aligned in the Chinese side. So we'll try to generate a pronoun here. So that's the basic idea. So this is the word alignment. So this is English sentence, this Chinese sentence, and we can find that I is misaligned, is not aligned. So we guess the position of the dropped pronoun from the alignment, the aligned words of the neighbor of this word. So we can see that want is aligned to this Chinese word. You is aligned to this Chinese word. So we guess this the missing pronoun in Chinese set should be between these words, between these words. So then this give some hints of the dropped pronoun in Chinese. So we can see this is possible positions for Chinese pronoun, and then we will use a language model to find the best position. So first we need to find the best position, and then we need to predict what is the Chinese pronoun here. So I, in Chinese, should be 我. That's simple, but simple. But sometimes an English word may be aligned to different Chinese words. So we still need to predict which Chinese pronoun should be recovered in Chinese side. So that is the basic idea of this work. So I will not go to the details of this this work. So I just will speak quickly. Okay. So actually, the basic idea, one of the idea is we use a reconstructor. It's a bit like autoencoder. So use this idea to recover the drop pronoun from in the Chinese side. Okay, so today my talk will mainly focus on document level neural machine translation. So I will give an overall introduction of this topic. There are many work on this topic, but I will not only talk about our work. I will talk about several others' work, including our work. So document level translation is very interesting. It's a very interesting topic. So here is another example. So about the analysis of document level translation and the sentence level. This is published by Rico last year in EMNLP. So because there is a famous paper published by Microsoft. So they say that their system achieve a human parity in Chinese English translation in news domain. But actually, if we go deep, we analyze the text in detail, we'll find that it's not the case if you analyze the data in the document level. So here is their evaluation. So if we evaluate the data in the sentence level, we can see MT seems better than MT seems better than machine. In document level, but this adequacy and fluency. So this machine translation, this is human translation. In the sentence level, we can see MT seems to have more in the more in 20 in 50 sentence MT beat human translation, and in only 41 human bit MT. So it seems that MT is better than human translation in sentence level. But if you consider the document level, consider context of the translation, we can see that human is much better than machine translation. So this is their analysis. Also, they give an example here. So the same phrase, wishing nurture, is translated in different ways, in many different ways. In English. Okay, sorry. So there are already many similar work in the SMT framework. So there are two different main strands on document level translation in statistical machine translation framework called cache-based approach and the document level decoding. So this is related work in SMT framework. So then I will introduce some work on the Okay. So this is our work in EMMP 2017. So our group is to work on this topic quite earlier. So in this work, we borrow some idea from the document level NLP tasks for other tasks, for example, for conversational tasks. So this work simply concatenate the previous utterance together as an input. So for query suggestion, so they proposed a hierarchical recurrent encoder decoder. Okay, so this for dialogue system, for dialogue response generation, also they use this hierarchical recurrent encoder decoder. So actually we also use this model for machine translation, for neural machine translation. So this is our idea. So you can see that, so this is a normal LSTM, so recurrent neural network based neural machine translation with attention. So we use this hierarchical encoder decoder model. So we can see that for each, we use maybe several previous sentence. After some experiments, we find three history sentence. Is the best. We have got the best result. So we use three sentence here, and for each sentence we use the LSTM or any other maybe a GRU model to generate a hidden state. For this sentence, we use the last, which is the hidden state of the last word. So we can use this is, and also we use another sentence level recurrent neural network to generate the document and the document level recurrent state. So finally, we use this state as the history of the document of the before this sentence, and we feed this hidden state to the neural machine translation system. So that's the basic idea, and there we suggest three different ways to incorporate, to integrate the context, global context. So the first idea is to use initialization. That means we use this cross-sentence context to initialize the hidden state of the encoder and the decoder. So that's the one idea. The second idea is we use the content hidden state to work together with the dynamic intra-sentence content. So use the as part of the attention model. So we use it together with this attention model to predict the current target word for each word, the target words for each target words. So for each target words, we use this as part of the attention. Okay. So another idea, we use a gate. We use a gate here. So this is the standard decoder. This is the previous target word. This is the previous hidden state, and this is the content of the this attention. This summary. Content of source content of the of this word and this activation function. So we can use this content here to jointly predict the this word, and here we use a gate. We use a gate, so to determine how many informations we should use from the content. So that's the idea. So actually, finally, we find this model works the best. So this is the experiment. So we use, so this is quite early work, so we use the baseline Nematis as the baseline system. Okay, wait, so this is some case study, so I will not. So we can see that we distinguish two kinds of errors, so ambiguity errors and inconsistency errors. So we can see that our model fixed 29 of the ambiguity errors, and but generate 7 new errors. We fixed 24 inconsistent errors and generate 8 new inconsistency errors. So finally, overall, we got some improvement. So this is our work. So there are also some other works on this topic. So this is use multi-attention. So for this idea, they use another attention, another recurrent neural network encoder as additional encoder. So this encoder is the current sentence. Also, they combine several of the history sentence and use another encoder to generate the hidden state for each word in this history sentences, and they use multiple attention. So addition to this attention, they also use another attention model to generate the current word. So this is the second work. Okay, there is another work called cache model. So this I like this work quite much. So it's very good work. So they use a key value memory network to remember in which content you should translate to which word. So this is a very interesting, very good idea. So they use this a cache model as a key value. So this key value, the key is the source context. The value is the target context. So whenever you translate some word, you store the information to this cache model. And when you translate a new sentence, new words, so you will use this source context to retrieve the target context and use this history target context to help you to find better translation for the current target words. So it's a very clever model. So we compared our work with these two models. So in this three data set, so LDC data, and this is TV subtitle data, this is TED Talks subtitle data. So we can see that all models consistently outperform the baseline in all domains. And our model works the best in the news domain, in this LDC domain. And then we can see the best model is the cache model. So it works much better than the baseline in these two domain, in these two dialogue. But in news domain, our model is the best one. So this multi-attention model only got a minor improvement on this data set. So also, this is the comparison of the model complexity. So you can see that the parameters is not the cache model is the smallest model for the speed. So the cache model is only a little bit slower than training in the training, but our model is much slower than in the training. But for the test, all the model works similar. Okay. So this models is this the three models is RNN based model. So recently, there are more work on transformer-based model. So I will also introduce two of the work on document-level transformer-based model. So the first model is called hierarchical attention networks. So they try to keep the cross-sentence context in the structure in a dynamic manner. So because the transformer is very strong, so it provides a very strong baseline. So it's not easy to get improvement on the transformer model. So this is the hierarchical attention network. So you can see that they also use the several previous sentence to help the current sentence. So they use multi-head. They also use multi-attention ahead. So this is use this multi-attention to generate a hidden state of the each word for previous sentence, and they also use document level to generate the hidden state for the at the sentence level. So we can see, and then when they translate a new sentence, a new word, so they use this hidden state to as the query to attend to this word, to the previous word, also attend to the sentence level information, and you integrate all this information and to help use gate here to help to generate the current translation. So this is called a hierarchical attention network. This is another work. So this is a work on last year. I think there's maybe some new work in this year's conference, but I did not include here. So this is the last year's work. I think this is quite strong. This work is very I think it's at least at that state, at that time is a state of the art. So they use They extend the transformer with a new context encoder to represent document level information. Also, they introduce a two-step training method to take full advantage of abundant sentence level, parallel corpora, and the limited document level, because we don't have many document level parallel corpora actually compared with the sentence level corpora. So this is the idea of their work. So this is the standard transformer-based neural machine translation system. So you can see that they use this additional transformers here. So self-attention and feed-forward use multiple layers and generate the state of each word. And they feed these attentions to the encoder. So for the encoder, at each state, they will attend to the previous sentence, not only the words in the current sentence. So they will generate a key here, generate a query here, and generate to find the also you know transformer. So it's a Q, K, V, okay, Q, key, and the values. So they will use some keyword here, the query here to find some information from the content sentence, context, and feed to the current, feed to the encoder of the current sentence. Also, they use the same information to the decoder. So this is the model for the for this work. Also, they use the two-step training. So in the first step, they train the neural machine translation in the sentence level. So you can see they train these models. They train this standard neural machine translation. So you can see this is blue. Modulus are trained in the pre-training, and then the second step they train the document level model. So you can see these red modules are trained in the second stage. Okay, this model is quite strong. So it actually, I think it's the best model at this moment. So that's all. So today I have introduced our work on. First, I introduced the DP in the Dropper Now translation. So we build a corpus. We build a Dropper Now corpus. Use some TV subtitles. So this corpus you can download it freely in the internet. So also we build a DP generator to try to recover the Chinese, the dropped pronounce in the Chinese side. And we propose a DP reconstructor. I didn't introduce this in detail, but you can, if you are interested, you can find that in our papers. And also we propose another model to joint predict the drop pronounce and translate the drop pronounce. Okay, about the document level neural machine translation, we introduced several models in the recurrent neural network framework and the transformer neural network. So for this neural network, we introduced three models, so hierarchical, recurrent encoder decoder, and multiple attention. So this is our work, so, and also cache models. And in transformer-based models, we introduce hierarchical attention network and context encoder and the two-step training. Okay, so this is the our open source corpus and our source code, open source and source code of our work. Okay, so this is a very, I think the document level is a very, translation is a very challenging topic, also very interesting. So we are still working on this topic. So one direction I'm very interested is the evaluation of document level. So at this moment, we still use BlueScore to evaluate the trans. So we can see a tiny improvement, but actually, I don't think this improvement reflect the real improvement of the translation because we didn't evaluate in the document level. So the document level evaluation is an interesting topic. So there are some preliminary work many years ago, but there are not, I don't see much work on this topic. But there's also some good idea, good news. Because if you read the report on this year's WMT evaluation, so they also already start the human evaluation on document level. So they evaluated the sentence with the context, not only with the sentence itself. So that's good news, because with such kind of human evaluation data, it's better. It will be very easy for us to develop new metrics for document level translation. Also, another direction is use pre-trained language models, so like BERT, GPT, for document level MT. We have done some work, and we have submitted a short paper to EMLP. We are still waiting for the result. Okay, thank you.